it. And then and then afterwards, once it's gone live, I have to mute the land on the side. It's kind of a funny thing I have to do. Everybody okay? Everybody enjoying the spring coming in?
Yeah. Unfortunately, I can't open the window because I have this construction site here.
Ah, sorry. Actually, you have enough air. You have 1 minute to fill the air of the room if you like. Let's see. Oh, it's all good. Finalizing, I have a birthday celebration on Thursday for somebody that I'm the bartender. So I have a cocktail menu of 10 cocktails that I have to do. All this hard work. So Matthias, just before you, because you're going to hear about this, so the speakers are getting a package of wine. Unfortunately, not you, because you work for Johannes Gutenberg University. So don't come, sorry.
Well, I promise
I will. You can get it from downstairs.
I was about to say, I come to your place and then I get not much promise, better and much more.
Once the corona is over, it's all yours. Anyway, so this is for everybody that's listening that would like to be a seminar speaker. You know, there will some motivation power here.
Nairo, I said that I can host the other talk.
The one on Barbara's birthday, yeah?
Oh. Yeah, exactly, from Chiara. Yes, no problem. Happy.
Okay, I think I had the wrong hang on for a second. Okay. Okay, let me start. Alrighty. So welcome everybody. Before we start, I'd like to welcome everybody to the online Spice Spin Plus X seminars. It's organized by the Spin Phenomena Interdisciplinary Center, Spin Plus X Collaborative Research Center, led by Martina Schliemann, Burkhard Hillebrand, and Matthias Chloe here in Mainz. As you guys know, this is a webinar format, so you guys will be listening to the speaker, Christian in this case, and then please write your questions in the chat, in the Q&A portion, and then I will afterwards handed you the microphone rights to ask the questions directly. And just as you know, please check out that we still are filling more slots for May, but we have lots of very good speakers lined up in the next few weeks as well. So one person doesn't need introduction. I just realized that the picture was the wrong one, so I put, I got rid of that one, yeah. So Christian's back is very well known in our field of spin tonics. He has led many physics, particularly in spin calorimetrics, and also now very active in the field of skirmionics and spin orbitorix. Was in Regensburg for quite a long time and moved recently in the last few years to Munich. And with that, I think that's all I need to say to introduce him. And please go ahead and share your screen, Christian. You can begin when you wish.
Okay, so thank you very much, Caro, for this invitation. I must say it's the first Zoom talk that I give. I so far have refused to give Zoom talks. So let's see how this goes. So what I want to talk about is how we detect spin orbit fields in, let's say, prototypical devices, and we're mostly interested in really the fundamentals. So what is the origin of the spin orbit fields, how we can detect them, and what are some spurious effects and problems that we have. And we use both optical and electrical detection. So I will briefly show what is shown here. I will introduce our model system, which is iron gallium arsenide. I will introduce the spin orbit ferromagnetic resonance technique, which we use to detect the spin orbit fields. I will show you how we can control the voltage control the spin orbit fields by voltage. And then finally, I will show you a new technique that we developed because we experienced some problems in all electrical detection of spin orbit fields in highly resistive materials. Now, this has been mostly done still in Regensburg, and the two key players here are Lin Chen, shown here, and Matthias Kronseder. Matthias grows the samples and Lin Chen does most of the measurements. But there is, of course, a large group behind it, and in particular the groups of Dominique Bujard, Jaroslav Fabian, Dieter Weiss, and my own group. And now the optical experiments are actually done at TU Munich, where I moved to about 3 years ago. And the funding you can see here is coming from mostly from the DFG, and in case of Lin Chen, also from the Humboldt Foundation. So to start off, I would like to remind you of this rather old experiment. So this was done in published in 2009. And here what you can see is a gallium-manganese arsenide single crystalline disk. And it has this sun-shaped structure, and these are current leads. And now you can route the current between different contacts here. And depending on how you run the current, you can generate spin orbit fields in this material. So this is a single crystalline material, gallium manganese arsenide. It lacks bulk inversion symmetry. And so it shows spin orbit fields. And this is mostly of the Dresselhaus type. And you can use this actually to switch the magnetization. Now, a few years later, you all know this experiment. It has been discovered that in these platinum cobalt aluminum oxide ultra thin films, you can also manipulate the magnetization, which is shown here as a black or white arrow. Indeed, you can switch it from up to down by running a current through this platinum underlayer. And what was first thought that this is caused by a Rashba type effect coming from this interface, but now we know that it's mostly a spin Hall effect dominated. And here it's a polycrystalline material, and it's an interface effect. I was assumed that it's mostly an interface effect, and it was also room temperature. And then a few years later, Chiara Ciccarelli published this result, where you can see this is a nickel manganese antimony film. Now this is again a bulk spin orbit material. And the nice thing about these experiments was that you could perform them actually at room temperature now. Now, we should quickly have a look at what spin orbit fields are, or spin orbit torques. Some people name it differently. And in particular, I will not look at the bulk materials now, but I will look at interfaces between heavy metals, that's the material shown in blue here, and ferromagnets, that's the yellow material here. Now, this is taken from this review here. And what is shown here is that if you run a charge current in the heavy metal material, you'll get a separation of spin carriers. And actually here, you should be careful if you draw electrons or how you define your current direction. But in fact, so what you do is you separate the spin up and spin down carriers on all sides of these heavy metal material. And now you can basically push this spin information into the ferromagnet, and there it will act as a torque on the magnetization. And you have two types of torques. You have a field-like torque and a damping-like torque. And the name comes from the Landau-Lischitz-Gilbert equation, which governs the motion of the magnetization. So one just enters as a field, and the other torque enters as a damping term. Now, you can have other effects at these interface. So this is shown here. It's the inverse spin galvanic effect, which is at this interface. Now you can see there's only a spin accumulation here, and this spin accumulation in connection with the magnetization can again lead to manipulation of the magnetization. And again, you will get a damping-like and a field-like torque. So you get two types of torques. The field-like is written as this double cross product here, and the damping-like, you have this triple cross product here. Now, it has also been calculated. This is a paper from Amin and Stiles, and you can see that indeed spin Hall effect and inverse spin galvanic effect both give you contributions in the for the damping-like and for the field-like torque. Now, these contributions may differ, and this is plotted here as a function of thickness. They might differ in amplitude, and they might also differ in sign, and it really depends on what material and what interface you are looking at. Now, you can, instead of looking at the torques, you can also look at the so-called spin orbit fields. And you can see here for the case of the spin Hall effect, this spin orbit field is connected to the charge current that you run in this heavy metal material. And there's a constant here, which is the spin Hall constant, which tells you how efficiently you can convert a charge current into a transverse spin current. Now, similarly, at for this inverse spin galvanic effect, you can define a spin orbit field that is proportional to the charge current, and there is this constant alpha here, which basically gives you this spin orbit interaction at this interface here. And just to make this more complete, you also find the names Bkov-Rashba, Rashba-Edelstein, or just Rashba effect in the literature. And you have to be a bit careful, this is not the Rashba of bulk materials as you find it in germanium telluride, for example. Okay, now we have these two effects, and you can see just by looking at these drawings that it's basically impossible to disentangle where which torque comes from, or it's quite difficult. And this is one of the main tasks, I think, that we still have to solve in the next few years or so to really be able to separate these effects. Now, why do we not want to know this? I show this very nice example. So I go back to this cobalt platinum interface with aluminum capping. And there was a recent very nice experiment from the Gambardella group where they could show that if you now push a current pulse through this platinum underlayer, you can actually switch the magnetization of this cobalt island very, very repeatedly. This was measured by scanning transmission X-ray microscopy. And what you need to understand the switching process is not only the anisotropies and the Jarzynski-Maria at these interfaces, but also, which you can see here, you need to know the contribution of the damping-like and the field-like torque. So previously one has ignored the field-like torque, but now we saw, okay, this field-like torque is also important. So you need to know all these torques to understand how switching comes about. Now we did some very similar experiments basically at the same time. We also had this small element that we switch. In our case, we had a little bit more heat load in the system, and we had a worse resolution because we're using a scanning Kerr microscopy. But we came to the same conclusion that we need to know about the anti-damping-like torque and the field-like torque, as well as temperature and DMI, to really understand the switching time scale and the switching behavior in these materials. And just a side note, if you go to low temperature, we also recover this deterministic domain one nucleation that was seen in the Gambardella experiments. So we want to understand these torques. And maybe one more thing, we would also like to find materials that are very efficient. So for current-induced switching via spin orbit torques, we would like to reduce the required current density. And here's a summary of some spin hall materials. It was taken from this review here. And you can see this is a Drosophila material, platinum, but you can also see there are other materials that actually show much larger spin hall angles. And I don't want to comment about the size of the spin hall angles here. I want to make one comment though. In 2016, we proposed to actually use alloying to increase the spin hall angle. And that is quite interesting, because what you also have to look at is the resistivities. And if you now look at the resistivities, you can see in these metallic systems, of course, the resistivities are low, while in these topological quote unquote materials, bismuth selenide and bismuth selenide telluride, the resistivities are high. Now, if you do a comparison of the normalized power consumption, then you can see that you probably want to go back really to metals. And that's why these gold platinum alloys might be really convenient. So we think that metals are more interesting, but what we would also like to do is we would like to modulate the spin orbit interaction strength within one material system. So one idea would be, okay, we just add an electrode here and we gate the structure. So we do an electric field control of this region where we think we have some Rashba type interface. So we just add an external electric field to the built-in internal electric field. And maybe we're able to actually change and modulate the spin orbit interaction. And the charging energy is much smaller than the Joule heating. So this would be very interesting approach. The problem, of course, is that it's hard to control metals by the electric field. And the reason lies in the screening length. So if you look at the screening length as a function of electron concentration, you will see that it's very hard to get an effective a manipulation in the metal case because you have these very short screening length, while of course in the semiconductor, it's rather easy and it's done all the time for semiconductor devices. So the question that we had is, can we use semiconducting materials to control the metal? And that brings me to our favorite material. That's the interface between iron and gallium arsenide. So we were looking at electric field control of interfacial spin orbit fields in this particular material. So this material, I will show it in a second, has C2V symmetry. And this C2V symmetry leads to interfacial Bychkov-Rushba-like, and I would really like to emphasize the like here, and Dresselhaus-like spin orbit interactions. So these are not the bulk Bychkov-Rushba and Dresselhaus interactions, but these are the interactions that have the same functional dependence as the Rushba and Dresselhaus interaction. So what you then have is you have a built-in electric field, for example, at a Schottky barrier between an undoped gallium arsenide and the iron layer. And so we have an internal field that just comprises of the built-in electric field, but we can now of course also apply an external gate voltage and add an external electric field. And that allows electric field control at this interface. Now, of course, you only control what is happening here because then the metal still screens quite efficiently. Okay, so I will briefly introduce this iron gallium arsenide system. I'll show it here. So this is a top view on the material. And you see immediately from the sketch that these two lattices are perfectly lattice matched, almost perfectly lattice matched. So you can get very perfect epitaxial growth in these materials. What you can also see is that the size of the spheres here mimics the position in the layer. So iron is on top here. Then this red sphere is the first arsenic layer, then the green one is the first gallium layer, and then you can get arsenic again. And these black lines actually are the electronic bonds. And you can see that the iron bonds along the 1-1-0 direction. So you can see you have these non-equivalent directions in the material, and that gives you these C2V symmetry. Now this material has been looked at by our theory colleagues, and the paper is shown here. And they basically derived the band structure for a slab of iron and gallium arsenide and looked at which atoms determine the spin character of the bands and so forth. I don't want to go into details here, but what I want to mention is that from the electronic structure calculations, they derive the spin orbit fields in this material. So what they could show is that this C2V symmetry accounts both for this bulk inversion asymmetry that we usually know from the bulk semiconductors and structure inversion asymmetry that we know, for example, from quantum wells. And the functional form in the low energy region actually looks very much the same. So these fields lie in the plane. And what they then wrote down is a contribution to the Hamiltonian of the system, which contains these K-dependent spin orbit fields here and the Pauli matrices. And now, depending on how you extract the low energy values here, you can actually recover these Rushba-like and Dresselhaus spin orbit fields which are known for the zinc-blend semiconductors or asymmetric quantum wells. So basically, you do an expansion of these K-dependent spin orbit fields and look at the lowest lying fields. And an example is shown here. So this is this spin orbit coupling strength, so this W, and you can see this is the K dependence in the plane, and it really gives you this figure eight shape, so the C2V symmetry. And if you look at the vector field, you can see these are little arrows here that gives you the directions of the spin orbit field. And interestingly in this material, I don't explain more on this, is that if you switch the magnetization, actually, you can switch the symmetry of the spin orbit fields in some energy ranges. What you can also do is you can now go up and down in energy and check what do the spin orbit field look like if you go away from the Fermi energy. And what you observe is that you always keep the C2V symmetry, but you get higher order contributions. And this is what they call the spin orbit butterflies. And again, this is for two different magnetization directions. Okay, so the essence of this is that you get an anisotropic density of states at the Fermi level. And this is shown here. So here we have the structure again. So this is the iron slab. This is a gallium arsenide. And what is plotted here is the electron density as a function of position. And in black, you can see the electron density. In red, you see the asymmetry in the electron density if you compare these two orthogonal directions. And in blue, you can see the asymmetry in the magnetic contribution. So there's also a magnetic contribution that is asymmetric. And so everything comes from this interface. And you can see there is this interfacial layer that is really different from the rest of the iron. And this has been shown already quite early by tunneling anisotropic magnetoresistance experiments, where they can actually even see that you can switch the direction of the spin orbit fields as a function of energy. This can be seen in crystalline anisotropic magnetoresistance. And I'd like to mention this here. We also saw this in an anisotropic intrinsic damping that we measured for this material. You can see what is plotted here is the anisotropic density of states, which has the C2V symmetry. And on top, you see the damping parameter alpha. And you can see it also shows this asymmetry. And I would like to mention this because we did some recent experiments. We were following this behavior in the very thin limit. So this is data that we have not published yet. And you can see that indeed you see this anisotropy between these two directions here. But if you go to the very thin limit, you can actually see that this anisotropy changes sign. And this most probably comes about from confinement effects, because you confine the electron wave function to a very thin layer now. Okay, one side note, since we have this conductive layer at the interface, we might also expect spin galvanic effect to be present. And what we checked first is, can we see spin pumping into this layer? So just a reminder, this is the very old spin pumping data from Mitsukami and co-workers. What you see here is the damping parameter measured by ferromagnetic resonance, for example, as a function of inverse film thickness here. And what you can see, if you sandwich your magnetic film between copper layers, nothing happens. It stays basically constant. While if you sandwich it between platinum layers, which act as very good spin sinks, you can see that indeed the intrinsic Gilbert damping-like parameter alpha increases linearly with 1/1 the thickness. And from spin pumping theory, you find out that this spin pumping contribution to damping indeed should follow 1/T thickness dependence. And you can extract the so-called spin mixing conductance for this material, which is shown here. Now, interestingly, also for the iron gallium arsenide interface, you can see this linear dependence. And indeed, you can extract an effective spin mixing conductance. And if you remember the slide before, you will see that you actually get an anisotropy in the spin mixing conductance in this low field limit. Now, we can also look at the spin galvanic effect induced by spin pumping. And we usually do this in this geometry where we have our layer of interest in the gap of a coplanar waveguide, which ensures that we always have perpendicular driving fields. And then we rotate the magnetic field in the plane of this device and measure the voltage that we can pick up with these voltage probes here. Now, instead of platinum permalloy, now we will use iron gallium arsenide. And the results are shown here that indeed, if you put iron on this intrinsic gallium arsenide, so there's no conductive layer beneath or above the iron layer, it's just the iron that is conductive. And nevertheless, you can pick up this spin galvanic effect signal with the symmetry that you would expect from this effect. So there's basically a self spin to charge conversion within the iron gallium arsenide layer due to this interfacial electron density. Okay, now let's go to spin orbit ferromagnetic resonance. So again, I will remind you of this Bychkov-Raschba-like, and I emphasize this again, and Dresselhaus-like spin orbit fields. And we usually say this is due to structure inversion asymmetry, that's SIA, or to bulk inversion asymmetry BIA. But here, of course, it stems from this interface. And you can look at this spin orbit field like this. So here you see that the spin follows the momentum. And you have this, I only draw one side of the parabola here. You have this closure of the spin for the Rushbutt type, spin orbit field. And for the Dresselhaus type, you have this star-like structure or inverse star-like structure as shown here. Now at the iron-gallium-arsenide interface, we have both of these present. So you need to superimpose these two spin orbit fields to get the spin orbit field of the this interface. Now what you can see here, now you couple momentum with the Pauli matrices, but if there is no momentum, so if you don't run a current, there's also no net spin accumulation. Now things change, of course, if you now start running a current. So I assume that we run a current in the x direction here, then you will see you shift this cut through the Fermi surface, and indeed you will pick up a spin accumulation pointing now along the y direction here. And similarly, you can do this for the Dresselhaus-like contribution. If you run the current in the x direction, you will get a spin accumulation that is opposite to the direction here. So this is summarized here. And the strength of these effects is given by these constants here. So it's the Bitchkov-Rushbutt coupling constant or the Dresselhaus coupling constant. Now, this has been used for the first time in a very elegant experiment by Fang and Kuribayashi in these two publications here. And what you can see here is a bulk material. So it's gallium arsenide, gallium manganese arsenide, sorry. And you can cut out this nanobar from the bulk material. And we know in this bulk material, we have a spin orbit fields present. So all you need to do is run a current through this device and try to pick up the spin orbit fields. And the way this is done is shown here. So we run a time-dependent current, and this current will then lead to the spin orbit fields, which are then also time-dependent. And these time-dependent spin orbit fields drive the magnetization into precessional motion if the magnetic fields are not collinear. And if the material possesses some kind of magnetoresistance effect, you will actually get a time-dependent change of the resistance. And now you just simply measure the voltage drop across the device, and you should get a DC voltage by mixing these two quantities. And so this the experiment is quite simple. You use a bias T here, you run a high frequency current to get the magnetization into ferromagnetic resonance, but you get it into ferromagnetic resonance by triggering these internal spin orbit fields. And then you just pick up the voltage here and measure the voltage in these experiments. And we do the similar experiment here. So we have the bias T here. Now we have a five nanometer iron gallium arsenide device that is a few hundred micrometer long and a few micrometer wide. And we just pick up the voltage here. And now in our material, one has to be a bit careful because we have large magnetocrystalline anisotropies. So you also need to consider what the magnetization does if you apply a magnetic field along a certain direction, which is characterized by this angle phi h here, then the magnetization might not follow and you have to introduce a second angle phi m. So there are some dragging effects in materials with large magnetocrystalline anisotropy. And what you then typically measure is a voltage curve that looks like this, and you can immediately see that this curve is made up of two curves, a symmetric voltage trace and an antisymmetric voltage trace, and we can separate the two and fit them. And you can see the separation here. So we have a coefficient for the symmetric voltage and we have a coefficient for the antisymmetric voltage. And what we now measure as a function of magnetic field angle is are these two components here. And what you can obtain from these experiments is, of course, the position of the resonance and the line width of the resonance. That's what you usually get from ferromagnetic resonance experiments. So basically, you can also extract the susceptibility here. And it has been shown in this paper that these antisymmetric curves give you the in-plane spin orbit fields and the symmetric ones, the out-of-plane spin orbit fields. So this is what we do. Shown here is now the in-plane spin orbit field as a function of angle. And this is now already the magnetization angle, not the field angle. So we take the dragging effects into account. And you can see this is the dependence of the voltage as a function of angle. And now you just need to fit this to this formula here. And you can actually extract these values that are in front of the sine phi and the cosine phi terms here. And these give you the spin orbit fields along these particular directions. So what else is in here is just the magnitude of the magnetoresistance effect, the current density, of course, the length of the device, and the magnetization. So these are all known quantities. And you have to be a bit careful in characterizing your system by ferromagnetic resonance, because you also have the susceptibility in here. But from this, then, you can extract the Dresselhaus and Bychkov-Raschberg contributions. And they're shown for this particular device here. So this device is structured along the 100 direction. And now all you need to do is do this for a number of different devices. So now you can plot here the effective spin orbit field. And you do this for other devices and normalize it to a current density. And then you can actually measure the distribution of the spin orbit fields in the plane here. So this is what we can extract from these experiments. Now we want to control the voltage of these spin orbit fields. And what we do now is what I mentioned before is we have this gallium arsenide iron interface. And now we build a structure where we can actually apply a gate voltage and gate this material. So add an external electric field to the built-in field of the Schottky barrier that we have. And a reminder, the reason why we want to do this is we saw in this calculations that if you change the energy, you get different spin orbit fields in these materials. And we wanted to see if we can indeed modify this spin orbit field strength and direction in this material. So to go back to this, so we have this iron film on gallium arsenide. We apply a gate voltage here. And if you do so, you can basically flatten the bands, or you can make the Schottky barrier steeper. And the summary is shown here. So as a function of gate voltage, you can change this internal electric field, not by a lot, but nevertheless, you add quite an internal field to the Schottky barrier. Now, what we then did is basically the same experiment. So again, we extracted these asymmetric and symmetric line shapes from the spin orbit torque experiments. But in addition, we also had this gate voltage where we can now tune the Schottky barrier. And the results are shown here. So you can see that this is for one particular field angle. You can see that you have the blue trace, which is the a small negative gate voltage. The green one is basically zero gate voltage, and the orange one is a stronger negative gate voltage. You can see that you indeed change the shape of this resonance curve. Now you can do this as a function of gate voltage and extract the values for the symmetric and anti-symmetric part. And you can see that indeed you can tune the coefficients here with your gate voltage. Now you can also look at this in the full angular dependence. So this is shown here for both symmetric and anti-symmetric voltages. You can really see that you change the amplitude of this whole 360 degree angular scan in this material. So we clearly see that we change the spin orbit fields. Now we can also plot the field parameters as a function of gate voltage and extract this slope here. So basically we change the Raschberg type spin orbit torque constant, if you wish, with a slope of about 10 microtesla per volt, while the Dresselhaus we change with about 2 microtesla per volt. And the results are shown here. So if you compare the 0 volt experiments to the minus 0.9, for example, you can see that not only the length of these arrows changes, but also you get slight changes of the direction of these arrows. And you can maybe better visualize this by calculating the spin orbit energy. And then you can see that indeed you can tune the spin orbit fields while keeping, of course, the C2V symmetry of the material with electric field. Now, I should say that the change that we observe is actually quite large with respect to the calculations that were done by our theory colleagues, and we don't exactly know why this is so. So one could think there might be some trapped charges at the Schottky barrier. There might be some effects within the barrier, but we don't really know this. But it fortunately is going in the right direction, so the effect is larger than what we would have expected from the theory calculations. Okay, now I come to the last point, which is which concerns the optical detection of spin orbit fields. So as I mentioned, we started looking at this because we had some strange results coming from highly resistive samples. So the standard techniques, the standard ferromagnetic resonance based techniques to measure spin orbit torques are STT FMR or spin orbit torque FMR in these materials. And typically what you get is some kind of a voltage trace that again is made up out of a symmetric and antisymmetric trace, and you do this as a function of frequency, for example. And if you ask people, well, could you show me the data for a very extended frequency range, you will see that there are some deviations in the signals. And we were also wondering about some very strange results we saw in topological insulator ferromagnet devices. So we decided to have a closer look into this. Just a reminder, these methods are sometimes also called self-calibrated. So for example, if you look at STT FMR for a ferromagnet non-magnetic bilayer, you get these two amplitudes of the voltages. And in the first publications, one assumes that this antisymmetric amplitude is related to the Oersted field and the symmetric one to the damping-like torque. And so they have these dependencies here. Now you just simply divide these two, you get rid of this the current density here, and then you will see that the spin Hall effect should, or this constant that describes the efficiency of spin to charge conversion, just is the ratio of these two symmetric voltages, symmetric and antisymmetric voltages, sorry. And similarly for the spin orbit torque FMR, one thinks that this one is connected to the field-like torque and the symmetric one is connected to the damping-like torque. Now, this is not all the way true. We notice in the meantime that there is, for example, the field-like torque term missing here. Nevertheless, so these are the most commonly used methods. It's a line shape method and it has been applied to a large variety of materials. So heavy metals, single crystalline ferromagnets, anti-ferromagnets, and also recently topological materials or 2D materials. Now there's a recent detailed discussion that is on the archive, and it's for people that really want to extract the spin Hall angle quantitatively, it's worth looking into this because in this paper, some of the discrepancies are described that you have in these spin torque ferromagnetic resonance measurements. So they give you hints how to do a line shape or line width analysis. So what we did is the following. So we used time and spatial resolved magneto-optic current microscopy. So what we have here is again an iron layer on gallium arsenide. So again, there's this, the only conductive layer is the iron layer, but it's very thin. And we send in a microwave current here, that's our J in. And you note here that in the ferromagnet, we call it JFM, because there might be a phase lag between these two current densities if the material is highly resistive. Now, what we can do with magneto-optic current microscopy is measure the ferromagnetic resonance line locally. So this is shown here. So we can go to this point P1, to a point P2, to a point P3, to point P4 and P5. And at all these points, we can record the ferromagnetic resonance line. And we do this at the center of the stripe, for example. And now here you see data taken at 12 gigahertz. So we fixed the frequency, we ramped the magnetic field, and we see this resonance line. And this is a 3.5 nanometer thick iron layer in this case. So for us, that's a rather thick layer. And indeed, you can see that these lines basically sit on top of each other. You might ask, there's something else coming up here at lower magnetic fields. And this is indeed because we have a confined structure here. So, and we will see this later, we indeed also have higher order modes in the system. Now, if you go to a thin layer, so this is now only 0.8 nanometer of iron, it's still magnetic. You can still measure a resonance line. The line is a bit broadened. But what you can see now, if you go from 0.1 to 0.3 to 0.5, is that the line shape does not stay the same. So we have a problem when we measure this device all electrically, because then we would mix all these different line shapes along the stripe. And the way we do it, just very briefly, is the following. We have a light source here, which in our case is a Thai Sapphire laser, for example. We frequency double just to get a better spatial resolution. We then focus onto the sample and detect the reflected light in a optical bridge here. And thus, since we come in perpendicular, we detect the dynamic polar magnetization component of the material. And what we then do is we synchronize the pulse train of the Thai Sapphire laser with an RF generator. And we have a phase shifter in between, so we can set the timing between the laser pulse arrival and the microwave train that we put into the sample. So we're sensitive to the out-of-plane component, and we have a basically an optical FMR setup with a spatial resolution of about 300 nanometers. And the pulses that we use are 120 femtoseconds wide, and we have an 80 megahertz pulse repetition rate. So we typically measure in steps of 80 megahertz, because we can only look at multiples of the laser pulse train if we use this scheme. There are other schemes where you can also go to other frequencies, which I will not talk about here. So it's basically optically detected ferromagnetic resonance. But what you can, of course, also do is you can scan your laser pulse across a spin wave, for example. This is shown here. So this is a side view of a processing magnetization. And your laser hits always at the same time, but now you can scan the laser across the spin wave, always with the same phase relation. And that then gives you two-dimensional scans or images of the dynamic out-of-plane magnetization of the material. And you can see this here. So this is a 2D map of the dynamic magnetization. So from negative to positive, we have an antenna structure here, and spin waves are excited. And in this antenna structure, and this is a permalloy film in this case, and you can see the spin waves running out in this direction, and magnetic field in this case is applied in this direction. So it's the Damen-Eschbach geometry. Now, you cannot only do this in the full film, but you can also do this, of course, in confined elements, and then you would see standing waves in the material. So now back to the problem of the electrical detection. So what we know is that in these highly resistive materials, we have a phase lag between this input current and the driving current in the spin orbit material. That's the one that is important for us. And in our case, the spin orbit material is simply the iron layer on gallium arsenide. So the magnetization is, of course, locked to this current here. So you can see this in a sketch here. So here we have in black the input current. And in red dashed, we see with the phase lag, the current that is actually in the device, which is proportional to the dynamic magnetization. And now, of course, we can set the laser to any fixed point here. So we can control the position of the laser with respect to the driving current. But in general, these phases are not zero. So what does that mean if you now have such a lengthy device? And you measure at this position, you might get this nice Lorentzian line shape. But if you measure at this position, you will, for example, get an antisymmetric line shape. And if you do an electrical detection, you will average these different line shapes. And that's problematic for highly resistive materials. So you get the wrong estimation of the spin orbit fields, of course, in this case. Now, the question for us was, can we still determine the spin orbit fields by using magnetization dynamics and specifically using this magneto-optic detection technique? So for this, we looked at two different devices made from the same material. In one case, we put our iron layer in the gap of a coplanar waveguide, and we run the exciting current in here, and this current will excite a perpendicular driving field, and we can then image the magnetization in this stripe as a function of magnetic field, so pick up the different modes in the system. On the other hand, we can take the same stripe and connect it to some additional contacts and run the current through the device. And now this current will create an asymmetric driving field. It's up on one side and down on the other side of the stripe. And in addition, in this geometry, you will also throw on the spin orbit fields. So here you have Oersted field excitation only. In this case, you have spin orbit fields plus this antisymmetric Oersted field. And you can also visualize it like this. So here, what is plotted is the dynamic perpendicular magnetization component as a function of magnetic field. And if you sit at this field, then this would be the mode profile of the first standing wave in this material. If you go to this field, you will get the second standing wave. If you go to this field, you will get the third standing wave in this material. So you have the magnetization processing across this material, but there is, of course, this profile of the standing wave. Now, if you run a current through this device, so this is this current that is now in the material, you will get additional contributions to the exciting RF field. You will get an out-of-plane spin orbit field, an in-plane spin orbit field, but then, of course, you also get this asymmetric Oersted field contribution within the material. And this is shown again here. So this is a top view. This is a stripe with width W. You run the current in this direction. And if you now just do a line cut through the material, you will see this is this perpendicular magnetic field coming from the RF current. It's antisymmetric. And then in addition, you have spin orbit fields, which are actually symmetric across the stripe. And this RF field does not contribute to all electrical measurements because you just averages out. Now, in addition, what we see in this material is that we have, if we make this width small, we can have standing spin waves in here. And now these standing spin waves, of course, are excited by different symmetries of the driving field. So this symmetric driving field excites the first and the third mode, for example, while the asymmetric driving field excites the second one. So if you now make the mode spacing small enough, so in the same range as the ferromagnetic resonance line width, we can expect the interference of the nearest modes. And that is our chance to determine the spin orbit fields. And this we will see in a second now. So here's the first test experiment. Test experiment also because we always compare it to micromagnetic simulations. So what you see here is a stripe that is the width of the stripe, about 4 micron in this case. And we then ramp the magnetic field, which is shown here, at a fixed frequency of 12 gigahertz. And at some point, we will hit the resonances of these standing waves. And you can see the first standing wave is here. So let's say at about 72 millitesla or so. And we see both in simulation and in experiment that this is the first mode across this stripe here. Now, if we lower the magnetic field, we can see both in experiment and simulation that we then excite the third mode. We don't see the second one, we don't see the fourth one, but we do see the fifth one again. And in the simulations, you can also see the seventh one, which is actually hidden by this sketch here. But there's also a hint that we see the seventh mode of this stripe. And sorry, it was not 4 micron, it's about 2.8 micron wide and 3.5 nanometers thick. Now this thing is now sitting in the gap of the CPW, so there's only a perpendicular driving field. So a symmetric driving field, and we expect these first, third and fifth mode. Okay, Now let's do the other experiment. So now we run the current through such a device where we have, in addition to the Oersted field, also the spin orbit fields. So the first thing you can see is that this picture looks drastically different. So what we plot here is a picture taken at a fixed delay, and this delay, phase delay of 90 degrees, that's the phase difference between the input current and the laser pulses. So this is a phase that we can control electronically by setting our microwave shifter. Okay, so what we see is we see the first mode, but now also we see something at the position where we would expect the second mode, and we clearly see the third mode again. But if you now look at line cuts here, you can see if you do a line cut through the first mode, you can see that actually the maximum is shifted by this amount delta, and you can see similar effect on the third mode. So the spin wave, standing spin wave pattern shifts from the center point, and there is a second mode that emerges that is not excited in the other case and excited by this inhomogeneous driving field. And from this, it's impossible to determine the spin orbit fields because we don't know this phase lag. So what we then do is we try to get rid of this phase lag. And we do this by just recording two images at two fixed phases that we shift by 90 degrees. And then we just, this is, I don't want to go into details here, but this is the curve voltage that we get out of our measurements. It contains the susceptibilities and these phase lags between the input current and the magnetization and so forth. So if you do this for two fixed phases at 90 degree and at 0 degree, we square these and take the square root, then we actually get rid of this unknown phase. And we can do this with our images. So let's have a look here. So this is one set of data for the phase set to zero. And here's one set of data for the phase set to 90 degree. And you can see these two images don't look alike. And from this, you can extract the image that is free of this unknown phase. So now we're almost done. All we have to do now is compare these results to the micromagnetic simulations and then use the fitted images to extract the spin orbit fields. And this is what we do here. So now here, first I show three different devices structured again along different directions. So it's the 110 direction, the -110 direction, and the 010 direction. And we do exactly the same procedure. You might see that the magnetic fields, of course, differ because we have different anisotropies in the material, as I mentioned before. And we always use the same drive current, and we have a normalized Kerr signal, a maximum Kerr signal. And just by briefly looking at this, we can see that for this 110 direction, the signal is 1.2 times larger than for this 010 direction. And for this one, it's the faintest. So it's about 1.7 times larger than in this direction. And this is also understandable. While the Oersted driving field is always the same, the spin orbit fields change. And in this direction, we know that Rushpa and Dresselhaus fields add up. In this direction, they actually subtract. So we expect a much smaller signal. And in this direction, we only have the Rushpa field acting in this particular system. So now we can use micromagnetic simulations to compare these two. And since we have these three directions, we can actually do a cross-check. And we find from the simulations, basically the best agreement between the simulations and the patterns that we extract from our experiments. And here we see that the sum of Dresselhaus and Rushpa contribution gives us about 0.28 millitesla, while here the difference between the two gives us 0.13 millitesla, and that allows us to extract the Rushpa term of about 0.21. And if you then do the cross-check experiment in along this particular direction, you see that it actually matches quite nicely. So indeed, this is a method to extract the spin orbit fields in this particular material system. And I should maybe add that we also tested this for ferromagnet topological insulator materials, which is also in this manuscript that you can find on the archive. So with this, I would like to come to the conclusion. So I showed you that we have this Drosophila for us, so this our favorite material, because we understand it so well, we can control it so well, so it allows us to extract some fundamental properties. It might not be technologically relevant, but it allows us to really understand some basics of these spin orbit fields coming from these interfaces. So, and this interface is dominated by the C2V symmetry, and for this you need Rushba-like and Dresselhaus-like terms. What I have shown is that you can get mutual spin-to-charge conversion at these interfaces. We could demonstrate that we can actually control the spin orbit fields by voltage because we use a semiconductor underlayer, and that allows us to make the ferromagnetic layer actually quite thick. So it's in the nanometer range here. And so we get sizable effects at these very simple interfaces. Then in this last experiment, I showed you that you have to be careful about the phase in these systems. So this is not an issue for many of the system studies. So if you take a rather thick permolar layer with a rather thick platinum layer, you don't have to worry about this. But as soon as you start looking at highly resistive materials, you might have a problem in electrically detected STFMR type experiments if your sample size is large. And then I've shown you how you can circumvent this for this particular problem. And it's a phase independent, self-calibrated approach, and can be applied also to other systems. We also looked at heavy metal ferromagnets, but as I mentioned, also to topological insulator materials. And with this, I would just like to summarize that we have these various methods now to determine the interfacial or bulk spin orbit interaction in these materials. I did not talk about this method. We actually started doing some very interesting experiments here, where we actually link the spin orbit fields to the so-called unidirectional magnetoresistance in the material. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Just even an applause. So I think let me thank you for a wonderful talk and very beautiful experiments. Let me start with Matthias Weiler. Let me give you the floor. Hang on a second. I'm not getting there. So Matthias, can you?
Yes. So you can hear me? Okay. Okay. So great, Christian. So yeah, thank you. Thank you a lot. Wonderful talk. I actually have two short questions. One is related to the voltage control of the spin orbitorcs in the iron gallium arsenide. So what is the effect of strain? Because the gallium arsenide is piezoelectric, right? Is there any effect of strain when you apply the voltage there or not?
It's a good question, actually. We didn't look into this. One should see it by simply looking at the shift of the resonance line. I would expect that there's not much to see, otherwise we would have noticed this, but I actually didn't pay attention to it. So.
Because you said that the change is actually larger than expected from theory, right?
But that's not the position of the resonance field, right?
Okay. It's the symmetry.
I must admit, we never looked into this, or maybe Lynn has and hasn't told me if it's a negative result. I don't know.
Okay.
I expect that it's not a large effect.
Okay, and the other thing is related to the optical experiments, because it's kind of like very interesting that you see that you get it, that you actually have to look at different positions and that you see some kind of phase lag. And if I understand you correctly, then you say what you actually see is there is a real phase lag in the current, which is like an electrical length effect. Is that correct? That is the reason?
Yes, if you want to say, put
it. Because I don't quite understand why does it really depend on resistance? I mean, I totally see why it depends on the size of the material and then of the velocity of light and the medium, right? These kind of things. But how is that related to the resistance? Is there kind of like a simple explanation why that is kind of like large for highly resistive materials?
Well, you can actually draw an effective electronic circuit model, and you would see that it does depend on the resistance of the material. Mm-hmm. So it's not only a size effect. I mean, then for this you would have to make your devices huge, right?
To
see a size effect.
So is it also related to impedance mismatch at these contacts, or is that kind of like really?
So you always have impedance mismatch, of course, in these devices, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you have a highly resistive material, so you will never be able to match 50 ohms over your frequency span. So So you will get an impedance mismatch because your resistance is far away from what you would like to have.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And it also depends on frequency, because you only showed it for 12 gigahertz, but the problem is more pronounced at higher frequencies. Is that?
Yes, actually. So we did not do a large frequency range in these systems, but you can see this in STFMR, right? So if you do STFMR for example, topologically insulated ferromagnet systems, mm-hmm. over a large frequency range, your signals line shapes change drastically.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. Michael.
Okay. Thank you, Christian. It was good to see you in 2D at least. I missed the first part. Are these iron gallium arsenide films covered or not?
Yes. So they're always covered with a thin layer of aluminum, which we then, when we take them out of vacuum, we know that they exactly oxidize all the way through. So I don't remember exactly. I think it's
But that implies you create an additional strain and you have an insulator on top.
Yes, but it's not a dynamic property of the material, right?
Well, it is connected to the piezoelectric effect, which you might have. So it's all speculation now from my side, in how far the damping mechanisms are really related to these spin orbit fields only.
Are you saying if you do a non-isotropic damping, it might be from the piezoelectric? Uh-huh. Okay, I have to think about this.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Okay, Sergey.
Hi, Christian.
Hi.
As a matter of fact, you have two types of experiment. One in very low fields where you measure the remagnetization, and then in high fields when you make resonance experiments. Do you expect that this spin orbital torque will be the same for given material, for almost zero field and large fields which you applied for ferromagnetic resonance experiment?
So with the zero field experiments, you mean which experiments?
Well, remagnetization. Well, you have shown in the beginning, the, for example, papers of Miron, where they just remagnetize material in weak field.
Okay, you mean the switching?
Switching.
I don't see a reason. I mean, if the magnetization is not, let's say, totally inhomogeneous, I don't see a reason why there should be a difference.
Because why I'm asking, the value of spin orbital field, which you present, millitesla or even less, is much smaller than the value of the field you applied to observe ferromagnetic resonance. Therefore, I would not expect to have any shift of the frequency due to, or visible shift of the frequency due to spin, due to field-like torque. That is my point.
Yes, okay, I agree, yes.
Okay.
But this is not what you extract, right? So you do basically it's a line shape analysis that you do, right?
No, I understand. Question is always when we do in our experiment and we observe the dynamics directly, we never see visible shifts of frequency when we increase this spin current or permalloy platinum experiment. When we increase the current in permalloy in platinum, we don't see any changes of the frequency.
You do see a change when you start cranking up the current density and you get heating effects, right? That you can see easily, but you see...
We see changes, but we do not see changes which can be connected with this field like torque. Of course, you have some you have non-linearity as well, but all these things can be nicely calculated. And then there is no room for field torque to change the frequency from our experience. That's all. Thanks.
Okay, Gisela, can you?
Yeah, Christian, thanks for this excellent talk. I have questions concerning the interface. You haven't shown a picture of high resolution TEM. Are these interfaces really always as sharp as you stated it?
Well, I mean, no interface is ever always as sharp as sharp as theorists would like them to have. Now, this iron gallium arsenide system is a very well-studied system, right? And so the way we grow them is actually in two separate MBE chambers are connected by a vacuum tunnel, so we don't expose them to air. So we prepare the fresh gallium arsenide surface. Mm-hmm. So we put in a wafer, we grow some gallium arsenide, then we transfer them to the MBE. So it's as good as it gets. Now, there are some experiments that are already some years old that were done at NRL in the US, and they showed the high-resolution images of these interfaces. And we know from these images that, of course, it's not like we expect them to be, but they're, let's say, partially intermixed. So we have partially also a bonding to the next layer, but still a large part of the system actually shows this anisotropic bonding.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
I mean, you will never get a clean, maybe except in the oxides.
But what influence will this make if you have not a sharp interface on your signals?
Okay, so this we know. So if you use a gallium arsenide substrate that you prepare externally, so you take a wafer, you prepare it by these standard techniques where you sputter anneal and try to get the 6x4 or pseudo 6x4 reconstruction, and then you put the iron layer, then a lot of the effects are gone.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So you really need this in situ prepared surface to get clear signatures of these spin orbit fields.
Yeah, this is convincing. Yeah, thanks.
Yes, Sumit, go ahead and ask your question, please.
Sure. So, hello, thank you for the wonderful talk. I want to ask about the spin hole angle. So the way I understand it, in 2D system, it basically tells you the charge to spin conversion efficiency. But when you are considering this 3D system, for example, let's say I have a platinum cobalt interface, how do you measure it? Because it might have a spread along z-axis. And the second thing is, as you show in your slide, the spin hole angle might exceed 1. So how can I see it physically?
That's a good question. So you have to be a bit careful if you do a 2D or 3D experiment, right?
Okay.
So if you run a current in the 3D material and inject into 2D or vice versa, you have to adapt it by a length, which has been shown, I think, by Albert Fert very clearly, that you cannot compare a 2D, let's say, current-carrying layer to a 3D layer. So you have to add one additional characterization step. And in the case of these, for example, 2D Rushba layers at interfaces, that's the effective Rushba length that you need to take into account. And that is also a reason why the spin Hall angle can be much larger than one, because if you don't take this correctly into account, you can get spin Hall angles of basically any size.
So this effective Rasch balance, is it going to be out of plane or in plane?
No, it's in the growth direction, basically tells you where your Rashba layer is located. Okay. Like, what's the extent of this Rashba layer?
Okay, thank you.
Jörg, go ahead and ask your question.
Hi, Christian, hi. No, I have a question regarding the voltage control of the spin orbit fields. When you analyze these spin orbit fields, you are using, in principle, the anisotropic magnetoresistance of the iron layer. And on the other hand, you have kind of hybrid states, because on the interface, as you say, you gate in principle the gallium arsenide iron interface. So your magnetoresistance itself may depend also on the gate voltage. So when analyzing your dependency of, say, the field like the Rashba torque and the Dresselhaus-like torque, or fields, how much actually you take into account that there may be a different anisotropic magnetoresistance, as anisotropic magnetoresistance of this hybrid system as a function of the gate voltage?
Yeah, we don't take this into account at all.
Okay.
So you're right, there could be a change in MR. It will probably be difficult to disentangle it though.
Could you measure not just the AMR at a constant gate voltage?
So probably you have done this again. Yes, all you need to do is do it as a function of gate voltage. So do angular scans as a function of the gate voltage. Yeah,
because also I think the AMR might be not just a uniaxial AMR type of thing. It might be more complex for this.
No, but in this case, actually, there is a crystalline contribution.
Yeah, exactly.
The AMR in this case, yes. Yeah. But I think the AMR in these thicker layers that we study, so if you have, let's say, 3.5, 4 nanometer, I would not expect a change in the AMR, because basically your bulk, if you wish, contribution masks whatever
dominating,
might have a change at the interface. So yeah. I would expect there's no change. If you go to the very thin ones, if you go to let's below 1 nanometer, there could be something observed, but for the thicker ones I can exclude it, I think.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I believe that's all the questions, and with that I'd like to thank everybody, 200 of you for attending. It was about 200. Let me stop now the live streaming here.